Take your Bibles to hand. I'm going to read Acts chapter 1, verses 9 to 14. Acts chapter 1, 9 to 14. After saying this, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go." Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, a distance of half a mile. When they arrived, they went to the upstairs room of the house where they were staying. Here are the names of those who were present: Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, Simon, the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all met together and were constantly united in prayer, along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, serving with other women and the brothers of Jesus. So far, the reading of God's word.
Just before I get into my message, I've just got an announcement or a request. This coming Sunday, I'm not going to be here. We're going to the national conference for the AGC out in Banff. Pat, myself, and Jason and Tanis are. Alan's going to be here preaching, Alan Workentine, for next Sunday. And that's a praise item because he's able enough to stand for however long he's going to be preaching. We'll see. If it's a short message, you know his back's not that good. But anyway, so Alan's going to be preaching. I'm grateful for Kelvin filling the pulpit last Sunday. That was good. But anyway, this coming Sunday in the evening, Creation Ministries fellow by the name of Thomas Bailey, is going to be giving two seminars here in the evening, starting at 7 o'clock. And so, although we're not going to be here, we need somebody to billet him for Sunday night and send him on his way. And also, we need a few people to help manning tables or bringing in books and stuff like that, because there'll be all the books for sale. So if you can help out in that regard, come and talk to me after the service or before we leave for Banff on Wednesday. So we'd like to have that. Oh, I see we have a brand new baby in church. That's a praise item, isn't it? It's in our bulletin, too, for the little fellow Lewis, for Shane and Heather's little boy. I think Grandma's holding him there that time, eh? Okay. Well, let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for every good gift. We thank you for the gift of this little fellow that you brought to our congregation not so long ago. And we thank you for the gift of eternal life through Jesus. We thank you for your word. We thank you for freedoms we enjoy in this country. And Lord, we would just ask now for your discernment as we look into portions of your scripture, and help us to gain what you need us to learn from it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I've got a question for anybody under the age of 12 this morning. Okay. This past week was the anniversary of the greatest homecoming in the history of the universe. What was it? Melody. Oh, say again. The ascension of Jesus going back to heaven. You know, he'd been out of heaven for probably 33 years as a human being, and he went back to heaven, completed his about 33 years of ministry. And so Jesus is in heaven now. What's he doing? This is just kind of a recap question for anybody. Those of you who are here on Thursday night all know all the answers, so you can put up your hand if you want. What's Jesus doing in heaven? One, he's preparing a place, is he not? I go and prepare a place for you. So he's building, fixing, making, whatever, creating. He's preparing a place for all those who are in his family. What else is he doing? He's building, but he's also praying, isn't he? Romans chapter 8 tells us that he is interceding for the saints according to the will of God. So he's not just twiddling his thumbs. He's building. He's praying. Praying for us, for the saints, believers, according to God the Father's will. Because sometimes we mess up our prayers, don't we? We pray for the wrong thing. We pray selfishly, or we pray for things we don't even know anything about. We don't know the whole story, but he straightens him out. He prays for us. What else? Well, he's our defender. He's our advocate, is he not? He defends us against our attorney, against Satan's accusations. I don't know how this works, but it seems that Satan has some access to God the Father, some form of communication. And Revelation chapter 12 tells us that he accuses the brethren day and night. And 1 John tells us that, I write to you, little children, that you may not sin. But if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He's our attorney. He's one who speaks for us, who sticks up for us when Satan accuses us. Okay. Now, what else does he do? He is our high priest, who communicates, he talks, he speaks on our behalf, he teaches us. But I think part of Jesus' work in heaven is teaching and being with, fellowshipping with all those saints who are already there. There's a pile there, isn't there? But only God can do that, have, you know, speak to millions and also to individuals. And so that is kind of a recap of the Ascension. That was an anniversary, I think, 1,990 years this year. That's a while back. Well, the close of Jesus' earthly ministry ushered in the new era called the Church Age. And this is the age of the working of the Holy Spirit of God through the church, through his people, the Greek word is ekklesia, called out ones. And it's the book of Acts that gives us some of the record of God the Holy Spirit working through his called out ones, the church, to accomplish the purposes of God in building his kingdom. You know, actually, this book is a letter or a document that actually gives us the most historical information about the activity of that first century church. The writer of Acts was the gospel writer Luke. He was a co-worker of the Apostle Paul. Paul referred to Luke as the beloved physician. He was a doctor by trade at first. That was in Paul's letter to the Colossians. He does that. This letter is to a man named Theophilus. Luke doesn't identify himself in the book of Acts as the author, but early church evidence and evidence from outside our Bible points to Luke as the author of this letter to Theophilus. Now, in Luke's account of the gospel or the life and ministry of Jesus, he acknowledges, first off, when he's writing to Theophilus, he acknowledges that others have recorded the events of the life of Jesus. But Luke writes to his friend, saying that it seemed fitting that he himself compile a written record of the events of Jesus' life after he had investigated them carefully and recording them so he could put them down in chronological or consecutive order so that Theophilus would have a better understanding of the truth that he had already received through verbal communication. And so the account of that gospel, Luke's account of that gospel story, was written about 30 years after Jesus' ascension back to heaven. And during that 30-year period of time, Luke spent some time in Judea, and he would have certainly conversed with the 12 disciples of Jesus. He would have spent time with Jesus' mother and brothers, her half-brothers. And so that's how Luke prepared his gospel. Luke was probably a Gentile by birth. He was educated in Greek culture. He was a doctor. And so that account of the gospel wasn't enough for Luke. He wanted to continue on with the history of the early church, the Acts of the Apostles, the Acts of the Holy Spirit. And it is a connection between the events recorded in the gospels and the letters that are written later by the apostles. And those letters were written to groups of people who made up the early church, not just in Jerusalem, but all over the Mediterranean world. And so this second letter of Luke to Theophilus, the book of Acts, was probably written or finished around 63 AD. That's about 30 years after Jesus' ascension. You know, after this period of time, there were a number of major events that happened to the church, at first century church. We know that the Apostle Paul was released from prison in Rome. We get that from his letter. While he wasn't in prison any longer, it was after. And so we can piece together that the Apostle Paul did have a fourth missionary journey after his first Roman imprisonment. Also, after this time, Luke records the execution of, or before in the book of Acts, Luke records the execution of the Apostle James by Herod. That's James, John's brother. But after the book of Acts is complete, we find from church history that James, the Lord's brother, was also executed. He was the head of the church in Jerusalem. We find that Peter, John, and Jude all wrote more letters, Paul did as well, to believers throughout the Mediterranean region. We find that the Roman Emperor's persecution of Christians intensifies. Nero and subsequent emperors see it as their duty to persecute Christians relentlessly. We find Paul was rearrested. Peter and Paul, as well as other leaders, were martyred. We find in 70 AD that the Jerusalem church, the city of Jerusalem, was leveled by the Romans. It was totally defeated, conquered, and leveled. In 95 AD, John wrote the book of Revelation. And around 100 AD, John, the last apostle, died in Ephesus. And so why didn't Luke record all of these events? And I don't have a good answer for it, except my guess is that Luke was probably martyred sometime between 64 and 68 AD under Nero's persecution. And couldn't write anything more. He was with the Lord. Cover all the events pertaining to the early church and the secular history, right up to the passing of the Apostle John, but it seems like the Holy Spirit of God didn't direct any of his servants to record it at that time. And so now what we do is we glean things from the letters written later. And we can try to understand the situations or the context from secular history, if there is. And even these histories, and early church histories, they are not inspired. They're not part of our canon of Scripture. Actually, in adult Sunday school class, Carl had another good video about how we got our canon of Scripture for the New Testament. And if you're interested, talk to Carl. Be good. But these church history and secular history are of value because they give us some context. They're not inspired, but they are of value in understanding the historical contexts of Scripture. But we do have record through the book of Acts of some of the events of the first 30 years of the growth of the church of Jesus Christ after his return to heaven. Just kind of a brief summary of Acts. The first half of the book of Acts, that's up to chapter 12, is mostly about the church at Jerusalem. It mostly deals with the apostles Peter and John and the other disciples, the apostles. Chapter 9 is about the conversion of Saul of Tarsus, turned Paul. Most of the events occur in Judea, Galilee, Samaria, or Syria, right around the local area, right around Jerusalem. Chapters 13 to 28 have more to do with the missionary journeys of the Apostle Paul and his co-workers. It's of interest to note that in the middle of this book, in chapter 6, which is Luke, he uses the words we and us. So it seems at that point Luke is part of the action. He's describing the Apostle Paul and his co-workers and what they did, what they taught. And interestingly enough, the book of Acts doesn't mention the three shipwrecks that the Apostle Paul experienced prior to the one that happened on the way to Rome before a trial before Nero. But it also doesn't mention the ministries of the other disciples besides Peter and John and Paul. I guess Philip had a ministry too. But what I'd like for us to focus our attention on this morning is the portion of this letter that describes the period of time between our Lord's ascension and the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. This wasn't a very long time. If you're under the age of 16 years old, how long a period of time was that? Any guesses? From the Lord's ascension to the time where the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost. Nobody knows, under 16. Okay, under 40. This is pathetic, you guys, okay. Okay, all you seniors over 40, how long was it? Comparatively speaking, yeah. Forty days from Jesus' resurrection to his ascension, from Jesus' ascension to Pentecost is, okay, I am a failure as a pastor. It's got to be 10 days. Okay, somebody knew it. Okay. 10 days, okay. Pentecost is 50 days after Passover. Jesus rose, you know, during that Passover Sunday, so resurrection. So anyway, guess we got to do some math teaching too. Anyway, so it was 10 days. Nobody gets a chocolate bar today. Okay, so. Well, the disciples had been instructed by the Lord Jesus to return to Jerusalem and wait until they were baptized by the Holy Spirit, he says, not many days from now. Now, previously, Christ's followers had been given the Great Commission, Matthew 28, to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them, teaching them to obey whatever I've commanded you. Mark's gospel speaks of going to all the world and preaching the gospel to all creation. And in this account that Luke wrote just earlier, he talks about going and being witnesses. Jesus' last words before his ascension is, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and even to the othermost part of the world after they had received the Holy Spirit. And so the disciples do just as Jesus instructed them. They go back to Jerusalem. They lodge in a place called the Upper Room, an upper room. But it seems as though the 11 remaining disciples, they are not alone during this time period. And so Luke describes some women being with them. Presumably, these are the same women who followed and supported Jesus' ministry, including Mary Magdalene and another of other women that were very supportive of Jesus' ministry all through his time on earth. But there was also, besides these women, there were also Jesus' mother, Mary, and his half-brothers. And so there was these, it wasn't just the 11 disciples. In verse 14 of chapter 1, we read, and these all with one mind were continually devoting themselves to prayer along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. And so they were with one mind, they were continually devoting themselves to prayer. You know that one accord, one mind statement similar to that occur throughout the book of Acts when describing the early church. That they were agreed, they were of one mind. There was unity in that group of believers. And so we see here again, they were of all one mind, this smaller group. It was actually bigger than just those people. In fact, if you read a little bit further on, in verse 15, it says, Peter stood up in the midst of the brethren, a gathering of about 120 persons were together. So there was the disciples, the 11, there was Jesus' half-brothers, we're not sure how many there were, his mother, there was women, and another a group of believers that numbered 120. You know, it's interesting, at this point in time, probably Jesus' brothers would have been recent converts. And it's commendable that the disciples have great unity with Jesus' brothers, because previously that was not so. That was not so. We have to remember a time when early on in Jesus' ministry, the gospel writer Mark records it in Mark chapter 3, when Jesus was in the Galilean region, Nazareth where he grew up was in Galilee. And so he is preaching and teaching in different communities around, not far from his hometown. And his family members get hold of, you know, they get word that, you know, Jesus is so busy he can't even eat. People are following him like, you know, like he is the one, the Messiah. And they get very concerned about Jesus' well-being, and they go and they seek to take hold of him, grab him, because in their minds, Jesus has gone off the deep end. He's nuts. He's bonkers, and I mean, he's a good guy, but he's sure not God. So we got to take hold of him. He's not even eating. Later on in Jesus' ministry, toward the end of his ministry, just before the Passover, I'm not sure if it was just a year ahead, it'd be probably at least two-thirds through. It's already when the chief priests and the Sanhedrin want to kill Jesus. And so Jesus isn't going up to the Passover right then, but his brothers taunt him, his half-brothers taunt him, and John records this in John chapter 7. His brothers say, you know, hey, what are you doing here? Why don't you go up and strut your stuff, show yourself to, nobody stays out here in Galilee, you go to Jerusalem. And they're actually taunting or mocking him. And then John puts a little excerpt in the end. He says, for not even his brothers were believing in him. Kind of interesting. His own brothers didn't. You know, he goes to his hometown. I mean, they try to throw him over a cliff because, you know, you were a good kid, but, you know, what you're saying, you've gone too far, Jesus. You're a heretic. So now Jesus' brothers are with his disciples, and can you imagine Jesus' disciples, you know, well, good of you to show up now, you Johnny come lately, before you were an antagonist, now you're, you know, but there wasn't that, there was unity. See, God got a hold of their hearts, see. Oh, they're all still human, but it was good that there was unity. There was more than just 120 believers in the surrounding region, because we know that according to 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus had appeared to over 500 at one time just days previous. But it's likely that in and around Jerusalem there was 120 committed believers who were serious about praying, waiting for what God the Father would send, for who Jesus Christ had promised would be coming to help them. So there was unity. There's something else commendable about this diverse group of people in that they were devoted to prayer during this 10-day period. You know, what a great idea to pray together with other followers of Christ as you anticipate the enormous task of being witnesses, of preaching the gospel, of making disciples of all nations. Just think of it. Wouldn't you be overwhelmed if Jesus said to you, hey, it's in your ballpark now, you go do it. You go make disciples of all nations. And you were only, here were, I'm not sure how many people, I didn't count us this morning, but what if, like, you were like 11 people? It's up to you now. Wouldn't you feel overwhelmed? I would. I always feel overwhelmed, let alone, oh no, you got to go save the world. They'll hate us, but we're going to do something about it, yeah. I can see why they thought they needed to pray. You know, they were probably overwhelmed by the task. They were overwhelmed in a sense that they didn't have their Savior with them anymore, leading them, guiding them, telling them what to do, correcting them when they goofed up and got it wrong. They didn't have that security the way they used to have it. And I imagine this is what drove them to pray. They understood that they desperately needed the help of the Holy Spirit of God to face the opposition of Satan and the people that Satan would use to try to thwart the purposes of God. And so they were united, they were obediently waiting, and they were praying. They were praying. They were doing something else besides waiting and praying. They were in the process of choosing a replacement apostle. We find that in verse 16 is where it starts there. And Peter takes the initiative and he makes reference to Psalm 69:25 and Psalm 109:8. As God using King David some 900 and some odd previous years to speak about a traitor to the Messiah. And Peter understands that this prophecy pertains to Judas, and in this case, someone else should take Judas's place as a witness to the resurrection of the Messiah. Now, Luke adds his commentary to what Peter said, to what happened to Judas. He does that in verses 18 and 19. If we read it, we can read it quickly. You can read it by yourself as I'm speaking. But this explanation is different than what Matthew describes in his gospel. But I believe it is more complementary than contradictory. Matthew describes Judas's remorse. He goes back to the Sanhedrin. He says, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. And the Sanhedrin says, well, that doesn't matter to us. So we don't care about that. See to it yourself what you're going to do. And Judas, in shame and remorse, he flings the money that he got for betraying Jesus into the temple court or whatever, and leaves, and he goes out and he commits suicide by hanging. He hung himself. And Matthew describes, you know, that they had enough common sense. You know, they could have just divvied up the money that Judas flung in there and said, oh, we got coffee money for a week. No, they didn't do that. They had enough guilt or shame about it. They say, well, we can't put it in the treasury because it's blood money. You know, somebody died because of this. You know, this is somebody, you know. So what are we going to do? You know, there's sometimes people die and we need a place to bury them. So we should buy a field that we can bury strangers who come to Jerusalem. And so we got a place to put their plant their bodies in the ground while they're, because there's no other place to bury them. And so that's exactly what they did. They didn't know that was a fulfillment of a prophecy of hundreds of years before that. I think it was Jeremiah. 600 years previous had prophesied that that's what would happen. You know, Bible scholars have surmised that what Luke describes here in the book of Acts goes together with what Matthew describes in his gospel. And this is how. It probably is when Judas' body was hanging for how long, number of hours or even days, and somebody cut it to the ground, it was probably already bloated and distended and in partial state of decay. And when Judas' body hit the ground, his abdomen broke and his intestines came out. And that's a pretty gruesome picture. It's for here us in the Bible. But it is probably how it went down. And in regard to the field of blood, Judas didn't actually buy the potter's field, but it was his money that paid for it through the direction of the Sanhedrin. And in that first century, that graveyard had the reputation became known as the Field of Blood. You know, Judas's story serves as a tragic reminder of how a person can have the best of spiritual circumstances and yet turn in unbelief and give up on the only Savior they will ever have and forfeit their soul to eternal hell. That's happened in this church, of people who spend a lot of time in this church. Well, Peter and the apostles believe that it is time to choose a replacement for Judas. But they give some criteria for this person. He had to have been around from the start of Jesus' ministry, actually from the time of John the Baptist. And secondly, he had to have been a follower of Jesus all that time. And thirdly, he had to be an eyewitness of Jesus' resurrection. And so in this group of 120 believers, they select two men who fit that criteria and whom they believed would be a good replacement for Judas. And we don't know how they did that, whether they had a vote or whether they cast lots, whatever. But we do know how the final selection process went. Verses 24 and 25. Two guys. A guy named Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also called Justice. So he had two nicknames besides the one. And Matthias, and verse 24 says, and they prayed and said, you, Lord, know the hearts of all men. Show which one of these two you have chosen
to occupy this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. So they chose two men, and then secondly, they drew lots, they cast lots. And it was Matthias who was the one who was chosen by lot. You know, some have said that the disciples should have waited for the Holy Spirit to come before they made that decision of a replacement for Judas. Others have said that the Apostle Paul was God's chosen replacement, not Matthias. But I would disagree with both of those assertions for two reasons. For one, the Holy Spirit had been present with the disciples during Jesus' ministry with them. There is no way they could have done the miracles that they did. In John's Gospel, we find out that Jesus, in talking to them on Resurrection Sunday, he breathed upon them, and he says, and the Holy Spirit was breathed out to them. So they did have, like in the Old Testament sense, the influence, the working of the Holy Spirit in their lives before the coming of the Holy Spirit in a new and powerful way that happened at Pentecost. They were led by the Spirit. They were using the inspired, the Holy Spirit-inspired Word of God, the Old Testament. They were using Old Testament scriptures to be their guide. Okay? So they weren't doing this apart from the Holy Spirit's ministry. Also, the Apostle Paul, for later, he didn't fit the criteria that the apostles set out. He wasn't there from the beginning and all through Jesus' ministry. He did see the risen Christ in his Damascus Road experience, but again, it was different than what the other apostles experienced. But Paul was called to be an apostle to the Gentiles, and it is surmised by Bible scholars that these 12 men were apostles to the 12 tribes of Israel. I guess that's why they figured they needed to top it up to have 12 again. One tribe would be missing their apostle. You know, some will say that through the rest of the New Testament, we don't hear of this Matthias again. But if you look at that, is true for most of the rest of the 12 disciples. We read of John and Peter and Matthew because they wrote parts of our Bible. We read of the apostles as a group. But most of them, the other ones, are not mentioned in Scripture again in our New Testament. Now, I believe that the apostles and the 120 believers in Jerusalem made the right choice. I'm going to draw a little bit of an application now in closing. In the not too distant future, our local fellowship will be making a decision on the leadership in this church, of this church. And though I don't think we'll be drawing lots, well, I guess we could if that was agreeable by everybody, but I don't think we're going to do it that way. I sure hope that we will be praying and asking for the Lord's guidance. Yeah. And I pray that there will be unity in our decisions. We struggled with disunity for a long time in this congregation. We need to be unified. Yeah. Now, we are somewhat diverse in our personalities. We are diverse in our ways of thinking, but the working of the Holy Spirit can superintend over our diversities and give us the unity that we need if we desire His will over ours. Amen? Okay. You know, in our congregational form of governance, we make a lot of decisions via a vote by the membership. And although this form of decision-making does have its shortcomings, I believe that God can use it to bring about His purposes for this congregation, provided we align ourselves with the truth of His Word and ask for the wisdom of His Holy Spirit. And so on that note, I would encourage all of us to pray about this upcoming decision. Also, if you're an attender, you've been an attender here for a year or more, I would encourage you to commit yourself to becoming a member of this local body of believers so that you can help out in making this important decision, so you can be part of the process. I think any one of the ministerial would be glad to talk to you and talk to you about what that all involves. So with that, I'm going to close this message about the in-between. How many days? 10 days between the ascension and the coming of the Holy Spirit, Pentecost. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for inspiring Luke to write down the history of the church at Jerusalem and beyond. And we thank you that we see how you worked through different people, from people who cursed you at some times to you drew them to yourself to become one of your most faithful servants. And so, Lord, we thank you that you're in the business of changing lives and you're in the business of changing our lives. And, Lord, we would ask that you would help us to be changeable in your hands, to become more and more like the character of Jesus through the working of your Holy Spirit, through the admonitions of your word. Father, we know that's your will for us. And so we can pray that confidently. We would pray for upcoming decisions in this congregation. We pray your will would be done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be dominion forever and ever. Amen.